I start? Do you want just kind of a background of where I where?
Well,
I came
you know,
from?
I like I said on show one, I talked about gravity and buoyancy. You know how they're in order for them to have the round Earth, we got to have gravity. Mm-hmm. And the science behind it, those who were instrumental, you know, in bringing that theory into us. Mm-hmm. But as it evolved to, you know, Einstein and his relativity, the colleges, how they've accepted, NASA, how they've pushed it down our throats.
Right.
The whole thing in and itself is a conspiracy. So I guess just what you think, if you were to talk to somebody for the first time, how would you approach it?
That's a good one. And when I try to talk to anybody that's brand new, I try to be gentle, because this is the one conspiracy out of all the conspiracies you've ever heard of that you can't walk away from. You can't even hide from it temporarily, which is why a lot of people get that Neo from the Matrix reaction. You know, they come out swinging, because with a lot of conspiracies, you can hide, burying them in the desert somewhere. You can ignore them, like 9/11. If you don't want to look at 9/11, you don't have to look at 9/11. But when it comes to your world, that's a little trickier, because there's a conditioning there which we've all gotten since we were children. But I try to open with this line. And you know, one, I try to size up the person that I'm talking to, and I use a lot of movie references, because especially in the United States, we all love movies. And I use a modified line from the movie Fight Club with Brad Pitt, and that is the first rule of Flat Club or Flat Earth is that you do not talk about Flat Earth, because people get really, really, they go through the five stages of grief. And the first one is denial, followed by anger, followed by bargaining, then depression, then acceptance. Because you, and I apologize for people that are listening now and are thinking, oh boy, now I've heard it all. You know, Flat Earth, this is something that was shut down 500 years ago. And, well, I come back and say, isn't it interesting that Flat Earth is the only thing we debunked to children? And you say, well, what do you mean by that? I say, well, when we start out in kindergarten or first grade or whenever you started out, there is a globe sitting in your classroom, just a model globe. It's not a photorealistic globe. It's not something that was compiled from NASA data. And it's been sitting in the corner of your classroom, if you went through 12 years of high school, all the way through your high school years. And then if you were unfortunate enough to go through your master's or your PhD in a university, then your conditioning is going to be even further. And then I come at him something like this. I say, you of course know George Orwell, the creator of the book 1984. He wrote an article back in the 40s, 1946 to be specific, where he said, you know, it's interesting. It was this article in the Tribune about how science has this grave responsibility and that people believe whatever science tells them. And he says, you know what's interesting? You go to the average person on the street and you could ask them, how do you know you live on a globe right now? And their first response is always the same. Well, duh, of course, we know it's a globe. You know, we know. And if you try to push them and say, well, how do you know? They start getting angry, which is interesting because that article was written in 1946. NASA wasn't even formed until 1958. So how did everybody in the world know it was a globe? And then you're saying, okay, where are you going with this? And I'm like, okay, well, think of everything else you can test. Fire burns, water is wet. You drop something, it falls to the ground. It's either being pulled or pushed, depending on which way you want to look at it. But it doesn't really matter. Either way, you can test these things. When it comes to the shape of the world as you know it, this is something that you're told. And you're told by a very, very small group of people. You can say, well, you know, NASA's bigger than the Manhattan Project. They've got thousands and thousands and thousands of people. And there's the other space agencies like the Europeans and the Japanese and the Chinese and the Indian and the Russians. I'm going, yeah, but they all started with really two groups. And that was the United States and then the Soviet Union. Here's the question I try to pose to people to start. I say, look, if they, up until then, there was, you know, everything when it came to the globe was just theory. And you say, well, no, sticks and shadows, and you know, they can quote all the math they want, but it's still just theory. Until you get a device that can go up high enough to take a picture of the world, what do you really know? So I pose this to anyone who's listening out there. If you did go up there and got high enough to take a picture of something, and you were wrong and it wasn't a globe, would you tell people? Would science protect its own like everybody else? And the more I started digging into it, and you know, we can go there, I'm sure you got tons of questions and different ways you want to go with this, but the more I started digging into it, the more I realized that not only is it very possible that we live on some sort of enclosed snow globe-y Truman Show terrarium planetarium type place, but that it's likely. And and when you try to go back to science and NASA and everybody else, and you try to lean on them for evidence to go to the contrary, you can't. You can't. There isn't enough. There should be. And people get mad in the science community when I say, look, the burden of proof is on science. I say, no, it isn't. You know, you have to prove it's a flat earth. I'm going, no, I don't. It's a court case. And what I'm trying to do is create reasonable doubt in the globe. And you would think it would not be easy to do, because there should be mountains and an entire warehouse full of information on the scientific side. And there just isn't. And I can give you all sorts of examples, and they'll, as I, you know, go into it further and further, it just gets spookier and spookier. But what happened was, towards the beginning of 2015, I gave up. I could not prove the globe anymore. Again, anybody that's into flat earth, they're not into it because they doubt the globe. It's because they doubt flat earth and they want to shut it down. It's like, well, it's easy. If you're into conspiracies, flat earth's a piece of cake. You can knock that thing out in a weekend. But I couldn't. And that was after 9 months, I couldn't do it. So I put a series of videos out on YouTube called Flat Earth Clues, with very little, if any, math to speak of, just connecting a whole bunch of dots, events that have happened around our civilization for the last 50, 60 years, and said, okay, prove me wrong. Show me where I made a mistake. And honestly, I thought that somebody in the academic world, a scientist and astrophysicist and astronomer, would call me up or send me an anonymous email and say, look, you messed up. You forgot to carry the two or whatever it was. And instead, the opposite happened. I had a whole bunch of people start supporting me, which was amazing. And then the interviews started coming, and then subject matter experts started coming in from different parts. You know, like all branches of the military service, surveyors, pilots, air traffic controllers, you name it. The only people I didn't get was somebody from NASA or an astronomer or an astrophysicist. And that was back in the beginning of 2015, and here we are, a book and apps and a convention coming down the pipe here pretty soon. And that's where I am at the moment. So that's kind of my general overview of how I try to approach it to people.
Yeah. My father used to say that people were educated beyond their intelligence, and I think this is kind of one of the examples of that. Not certainly giving, you know, anyone a hard time, but in reality, the education system, the brainwashing, the cognitive dissonance, you know, you were mentioning in some of your videos that nothing, you know, the astronauts, when they were doing the spacewalk or whatever they were doing, mm-hmm. there really was no 360-degree panning of any pictures to give us a contrast.
Oh, yeah, that was a rabbit hole that I didn't even come up with initially. That was done by a guy named Max Malone, who wasn't really even a flat earther at the time. He is now. Who didn't believe in the American space program. He said that there's something wrong with the entire Apollo program. He goes, but every aspect of Mercury and Gemini and the ISS and Soyuz and everything. He goes, there's something really wrong there. And what he said was, and he was absolutely right, was that in all the missions that have ever been done, no astronaut has ever filmed a segment of footage with his camera outside of the space station where he turns 180 degrees or further. And you'd think, well, that can't be the case. But it is. And you'd think it would at least happen on the moon. You know, you leave the camera running, you do a 360. Statistically speaking, and I'm a stats nut, that should have happened by accident years and years ago. Somebody, you're telling me that nobody in the ISS has ever turned around outside of the spacecraft, you know, with the camera? No, they haven't. You see still shots. You'll see a series of still shots and maybe a little video footage and then some more still shots, but they won't do it. And then as we started digging, the community started finding more and more things that aren't there. And that's one of the key things you got to look for here. It's not what we found initially when it came to the space program. It's what we didn't find. For example, there was only one ever released photo of the full Earth in sunlight, you know, the disc, the blue marble shot, mm-hmm. taken from 1972 up until the summer of 2015. Literally only one for 43 years. And that raised a whole lot of eyebrows on our side of the fence, because that shouldn't even be possible. You're telling me that Hubble never turned around, or no satellite that ever, a geostationary satellite that ever got out to a certain distance didn't take a picture there? No, they didn't. There was only one, and we all know what it was. It was the Apollo 17 supposed shot that only shows, which is weird, the bottom part of Africa and all of Antarctica. Again, no coincidence. They killed two birds with one stone there, but I'm getting ahead of myself. There's no movies of the Earth rotating on its axis with the weather morphing. Even though we've got some, the rotation, especially the well-known Galileo 1990 shot, the Earth goes through a 24-hour process, but the clouds don't move, which means the whole thing was fabricated. There's no footage of any device from the device's point of view or any other point of view leaving or entering Earth's orbit ever. The ISS that's coming up on its 20-year anniversary, which is next year, 20 years of the ISS, there is no time-lapse footage of any kind showing how it was constructed, who constructed it, what pieces went on first. And 20 years of people supposedly going up and leaving, and no footage. There's no footage of anyone even continuously running footage of any device going up to the ISS or going back into, you know, going back down to the Earth. You just and these keep happening over and over. There's just so much stuff that we assume is there, but it's not. And you compile a lot of this stuff, you start questioning, okay, what exactly do we know about NASA? What is it that they can prove? And it's very, very little. Like a man that was interviewed just a few months ago, he's going, it's thin. It's amazingly thin. But yet we have a huge amount of faith in it. And I'll go one more. The ISS, otherwise known as the International Space Station, you want to look up some interesting stuff? Go into YouTube, or, you know, because that's the great depository of wisdom and knowledge right now, and type in ISS hairspray. That'll blow your mind. And that is, in zero gravity, if a woman has long hair, it should flow back and forth like you're in a swimming pool. You know, your head will move first and your hair will flow behind you. But for some reason, the women that had long hair in the ISS, they had their hair permed up like the Bride of Frankenstein. It didn't make any sense from a production standpoint. If I was trying to fake zero gravity, that's the last option I would choose. The first option would be, cutting your hair really short, because any hair in a zero-G environment would be a hazard. Second would be put a hat on them. Three, tie their hair back. But no, they insisted on putting their hair in a really rigid up position, like they were going out of their way. It's like, this is what zero-G looks like. And they were doing this because they were the entire ISS footage is being simulated in a zero-G plane. You can pay money to go in a zero-G plane. It's called the Vomit Comet, because they call it that because stomachs are human beings. Their stomachs don't do well with the introduction of zero gravity. And that's what they're using for the ISS footage. There's nobody up there. There's nothing. There might be something up there. People say, I saw the ISS fly overhead. I'm going, that's great that you saw some fuzzy light fly overhead, but there's no people up there. There never have been. And if they're faking the interior footage, that means that there's a whole bunch of other stuff that's being affected. But I could go on and on. You know, I could spend an entire show just on the Apollo missions. But anyway, that's my continuation of the NASA and ISS.
I saw some video of a graphics artist or graphics personnel for NASA, and he mentioned about the CGI, you know, what he had to doctor up. He said it was necessary. He had to use Photoshop on all the pictures, right?
Yeah, yeah. That was the guy, the consultant they hired from NASA to develop the very first background for the iPhone. So if you remember when the iPhone came out years ago now, the very first background was a globe. It was a blue marble shot. But back then, like, and I ran into the same thing, he realized there weren't any good blue marble shots. So he had to create his own from composites. And he got lazy. And he was interviewed about this. You know, he wasn't shy about saying, oh yeah, I created for it. What was interesting was why he created it. He didn't really go into that too much. And that was there were no shots out there. I remember a story, I'll give you a perfect example of not seeing the forest for the trees. Back in 2000, 15, 17 years ago, I was running a tech support department for a time and attendance software company, and I wanted to put an iconic image on all the support monitors, which would have been the Earth from space. You know, I was going to put different globe shots, and I typed into Google or whatever search engine I was using back then, Earth from space or whatever, you know, Boolean strings. I knew a bunch of different ones. And as I was typing them in, no matter what I typed in, I kept getting just rows and rows and rows of one image. I'm not talking like nowadays where you see, you know, 20 different versions of the Earth image, but they're all composites. No, it was all the Apollo 17 shots showing Africa and Antarctica, rows and rows. That's all that would come up. And I remember thinking, as I was staring at the screen, I'm thinking, one, I must have lost my mind because there's no way this could happen. I remember thinking, NASA, you suck. Your online presence is terrible. Even though, in hindsight, I realized that they were actually releasing the only thing they could release. And so, yes, when I think his name was Scott Simmons, if I'm not mistaken, the NASA engineer, that software engineer that designed the background for the first iPhone, had to create his own blue marble shot because there was nothing else he could use. And it was found out, photoshopped, because the internet hive mind misses nothing. They went into, if you zoom in on it, you'll see the clone tool that was used, especially in the Southern Hemisphere. Lots of people, when they do graphic design, they get a little lazy. It's like, well, no one's going to know, not unless they zoom in and start really picking this thing apart. And he started cloning quite a few of the clouds. And that's when they put it to him. They said, oh, yeah, well, his famous line is, well, yeah, it's Photoshop, but it has to be.
Yeah, it has to be.
And he put that in audio. And it's like, all right, well, there you go. If anyone needs any more proof of and he was a NASA guy, not the main NASA guy. Now, does that prove, you know, that the Earth is a Truman Show? No. But it does prove that NASA fixes images. I'll throw one more out since you brought that one up. Which came to me, I was reminded of it recently, which was that if you look up not the blue marble, but the black marble, look up NASA black marble picture, and it shows a composite image of the Earth at nighttime. And it looked, you know, showing the cities, you know, the city lights from, I don't know, whatever it is, 20,000, 40,000 miles away or something like that. And when you're looking at it, there were some people, again, photography people, picked up on it pretty quick. He's going, wow, there's a lot of lights out there in Western Australia on that black marble shot. And as a matter of fact, some of these guys compared it to zoomed in on some great topographical maps of Western Australia. There's no population centers out in the western half of Australia. Everybody lives in the coastline. And yet they lit up the western half of Australia like it was the eastern seaboard of the United States. And it's like, okay, where are these lights coming from? Why did you add it in there? They just added it in for balance. It looked better. They didn't like Australia being all this dark mass, so they added in pretend population centers. That's one thing, in my opinion, to add clouds, you know, to clone clouds on an image. That's a whole nother thing to add cities that aren't there. I'm sorry. That's taken it too far, in my opinion. So, but that's just one instance.
I remember seeing, it was like six or nine of the blue marbles, and in different times, supposedly when they've been taken. But you know, between Iceland, Africa, the United States, they're different sizes. They don't, the scales are completely wrong.
Yeah.
Do you know which ones I'm talking about?
Oh yeah, I know exactly which ones you're talking about. And in fact, even this year, they released another one just this year. In fact, it's the new satellite, if I'm not mistaken, that supposedly takes a shot every 15 minutes. Of course, why there's no video, I have no idea. But the shot that's taken every 15 minutes was analyzed right off the bat, and the top of the United States was already into the Arctic Circle, and the bottom of Chile was where Antarctica should be. They were missing literally like 100 degrees worth of the sphere. And I'm going, this is 2017. We've already put you guys on notice. Why in the world do you keep releasing this crap? Yeah, we can't find any consistency with the pictures. It's almost like the different pictures that were taken were completed by different, it's the same agency, but different teams, and they just don't know any better. There's a video out on NASA.gov right now called Orion Trial by Fire. It's a video they put together, professionally done for television. And I think what's the name of the kid? I don't remember. It doesn't really matter. Where this engineer, he's on there and he's talking about the Orion Project is the Mars program. If anyone doesn't know what that is, you know, the mythical Mars program we keep kicking down the road. It's never ever going to happen for various reasons. One is you can't get there in the first place. But even if you could get there, you're not getting there because there's a huge fuel problem. You can't get back. So. The video shows this elaborate system where they're saying the first probes or the first capsules we're going to send are going to be unmanned, not to Mars, but just like to the moon and back and crap like that, because the Van Allen radiation belts are super deadly and we haven't figured out how to get through them yet. We need to solve that problem. And when you're watching this, all of a sudden, you know, if you're old enough, especially, you dawns on you, it's like, wait a minute, whoa, the Van Allen radiation belts you announced, that NASA announced in 1959, and supposedly Apollo 8 through Apollo 17 went round trips through them. Nobody died, nobody got radiation poisoning, nobody got cancer, but you haven't figured out how to solve these problems yet, even though you've solved them flawlessly in the 60s. So what are you talking about? Are you trying to rewrite history? Are you just dismissing the whole thing? It's mind-boggling. That video is still out there, and it was made in October of 2014.
So you know, I noticed that some of the pictures, I was looking at the moon, and some pictures taken, you know, by iPhones or whatever they used. There were times that the moon actually gave the appearance of being transparent, that maybe there was a star behind it.
Yeah.
Have you seen that? Can you talk on that?
Yeah, you bet. The moon is an interesting object. And for those, and I'm sure you kind of explained in previous shows what the flat Earth looks like, but when it comes to, because one of the most common questions I get is, what are the moon and the sun? And honestly, the more I try to answer that question, the more I don't know. Because all I can tell you is the sun and the moon, the sun isn't 93 million miles away and the moon isn't 237,000 miles away. They're very, very close. They're like a mobile over a child's crib. They're small and they're independent objects. So could they be a few thousand miles up? Probably. Are they less than 50 miles wide? That's a pretty good guess. But when it comes to the moon, man, that's a strange thing because, yeah, sometimes you can see, you know, there's been videos taken where it seems to be somewhat translucent and you can see stars through it. Another thing that's interesting about the moon is that it gives off its own light. And I'm not trying to be biblical here, saying, you know, the moon was designed to be, you know, the lesser light to rule the night sky. But the moon, when I say that, I mean the moon is actually self-illuminated. It's not reflecting the sun at all. And you're saying, well, that's not possible. You might want to look at some of this stuff. Like, for example, the sun, we all know, if you're in the middle of the desert, or doesn't really matter, you know, hot sunny day somewhere, let's say it's 90 degrees in the sun. Well, if you go into the shade of the sunlight, it's 80 degrees because the shade is blocking some of the sun's rays. We all know this is something we can test. What science doesn't tell you, and there's been tests done on this very recently, and they're all very good, very qualifiable tests, is that the moon is actually generating a cold light. And your first reaction would be, well, we all know it's colder at night. You're not telling us anything new. I'm going, no. The moon is actually generating a light that refrigerates things. Meaning, if it is, I'm going to use Fahrenheit, not Celsius, if it's 50 degrees in the moonlight, it's 60 degrees in the moon shade. It's the opposite of sunlight. And we've seen up to 13 degree swings, and you can go around and take a point and click infrared thermometer and test this on any good. It's better when it's high in the sky, obviously. And if it's a full moon, really helps. But anybody can test this. And we've had tests done that are, you know, on video, which are fantastic. And I was the first person to suggest, just on a whim, because I didn't even believe it the first time I heard it until I did it myself, which was, okay, if you take a magnifying glass to sunlight, you can burn paper, right? But if you take a magnifying glass to moonlight, what happens? Does it get warmer or does it get even colder? Turns out it gets even colder if you magnify moonlight. And this is something that can only be done with advanced technology. We can do this now. Just, you know, this isn't a weird a twisting of physics. We can actually generate a laser beam that cools things. It's called a cool laser. Universities have been doing this for years. But the question is, why is the moon doing that? You're saying, well, does, and then I will come back and say, does that prove that it's an enclosed world? No, it doesn't. But it completely throws the relationship between the sun and the moon out of whack. And what science tells us that's happening with the sun and the moon. If the moon cannot reflect the sun's rays, convert it into a cold light and beam it back down to Earth. That's the equivalent of taking a heat lamp, trying to bounce it off a wall in your house and generating cold light on the other side. It doesn't work like that. It's amazing. So the moon, yeah, very interesting. We've had a lot of fun with the moon. Again, it's in itself, does it prove that we are in a flat stationary world? No. But it completely puts into question two very, very big, you know, the most prominent things in the sky, the sun and the moon. So there you go.
You know, as you were saying this, it reminded me of the Peltier, of the piezo thermo element. On one side it's hot, the other side is cold, and we know it by the ones we buy as refrigerators or heaters that we plug in our 12-volt we can take with us.
Yes.
So as that triggers me, I actually want to look into that to see if there's any potential. And the idea behind that is when there's in the electrons, when there's a hole missing, it needs to be replaced. When it's replaced, it's actually drawing away. And so, you know, cold is actually the absence of heat. Without infrared, everything will drop down to a temperature that will absolutely freeze. So I want to look into that. Now, you talked about the moon and the sun not being the distance they've told us.
Yes.
The sextant I was researching, they've actually known this for a long time. So what do you think they're trying to do here when they're saying that it's so far away?
It is a way, if you're going to create the solar system model, if you're going to give science a jump start back in the day, you have to start with something. And redefining the world and the solar system is a great, great place to start. So when they designed, you know, when Copernicus and all his fellow scientists, even though Copernicus, you can look this up, you know, went to his grave and didn't have his work published deliberately until after he died. And I still think it was a massive leap of faith back then, but, you know, 500 years ago, who knows what the general population was thinking. But it was the foundation for science as we know it. From the solar system model came everything. It's like, okay, here's the solar system. You are on a rock spinning on its axis, spinning around, rotating around the sun, which the solar system is rotating through space. You are alone. God gets put in a corner. and, you know, for the most part, or at least you're very, very small in a very, very vast universe. And from there, then you can start building on the other physical sciences. And I still do believe that the creator or creators of this place, depending on how you want to look at it, wanted us to act naturally, which is why I did the clue sort of like on the wildlife preserve. And that is, and I don't want to steal too much from Agent Smith in The Matrix, but every other species in this world or on this world reacts naturally, or, you know, develops an equilibrium with the surrounding environment. We do not. You could put a buffalo in the middle of a beautiful 1,000-acre wildlife preserve with a beautiful fence around it. The buffalo could care less about the fence. It's like, I got grass to eat. There's a lake over there. There's some trees. I'm happy. You could put a person or a couple people, you know, in the same preserve, plenty of room to run around. All they are going to care about is the fence. That's all there is. The fence is the priority. Who made the fence? Why am I inside the fence? Who's on the other side of the fence? Did I anger the person that made the fence? Should I be appeasing said creators of the fence? That's all anyone care about. And human beings are unique in that capacity. So creating a reality where there was no fence, you couldn't just make the fence invisible. You had to give the impression that there was no fence at all. And science did a wonderful job of keeping that. I think that secret societies played into this, and people had the maps years and years, if not centuries ago? Yes, of course. But they couldn't do anything about it until the Industrial Revolution. Let's say you're the king of France in 1600, and you had a map that actually showed you what the real world looked like, which was basically the UN flag with a big dome over the top, a firmament, if you will. What could you do? You got nothing. You got wooden ships and you got horses. Even if you could get down to Antarctica, your expedition is going to fail. There's no way you can get enough resources to the edge of this world without aircraft. You can't do it. And so that's exactly what they did. You know, you look at the powers that be and the moves they made starting in 1926. 1926, and we'll get into this a little bit. Well, actually, you know what? I don't want to ruin it if you want to talk about Admiral Byrd later.
Right. Well, with that, you were mentioning about how the wildlife is content when it has its environment that doesn't seem to be restricted. Mm-hmm. But us as humans, with the lie that's been portrayed onto us that we can go wherever we want to. Mm-hmm. Now, if we have a dome over us, what do you think people would think if it actually became public information?
Well, that's where it gets tricky, because the population is, well, again, steal a line from the movies, Men in Black. People are panicky, dangerous, and you know it. Here's what happens. Potentially, the very next day, let's say somebody at the UN announces through an explorer that we are actually in a Truman Show that's thousands of miles wide and thousands of miles high. Well, some really, really big things happen overnight. First thing is that every university everywhere in the world, doesn't matter what country you're in, their astrophysics and their astronomy departments shut down. They're gone. They don't exist anymore because they can't. Astrophysics and astronomy is based on a solar system, and that just isn't there. Every other remaining science, and I don't care what it is, geology, hydrology, archaeology, biology, anything with analogy next to it, those have to be retooled from the ground up. That's just the academic sector. That right there is a huge shockwave to the system. Economically, you got some big question marks. With the first one being, do we still go to war if we are all in the same boat? If we are all in the same, I won't say petri dish to try to diminish our existence or anything, if we are in the same experiment, the same planetarium, terrarium, whatever you want to call it, then we're all part, you know, we're all one big, not necessarily happy family, but at least a family. Then it turns into the Ronald Reagan speech. Do we fight each other if there's a potential threat outside of this world? No, we don't. So what is that? What happens to all the massive defense departments and all the defense subcontractors that are out there? there's a lot. I mean, there's billions and billions and billions and countless billions of dollars tied up in the war machines. The line from JFK, a country's power is in its ability to make war. Well, if that becomes irrelevant, what happens? Does that country's economy still survive? Remember, the United States' chief export right now is military equipment. Big high-end missile systems and fighter jets and tanks and you name it. We build it and we ship it out there. What happens to the United States? And then lastly, it's the spirituality factor, which is last but not least, what happens spiritually to everybody involved. Meaning, let's say this place was created, because this is at the very least proof of intelligent design. It may not be the handprint of God on the wall, but at the same time, the five major religions of this world, that being Judaism, Hinduism, Buddhism, Islam, and Christianity, that make up 80% of the population, 80% of the population belongs to one of those groups. They're going to look at it and say, oh boy, there's been somebody looking over my shoulder the entire time. Now, I'm not saying it's an overbearing parent that's literally watching every move you make, but at the very least, you'd think that it's a parent sitting on the couch looking over the top of the newspaper every once in a while. Do you still act the same way? And some people say, well, of course I would. Why would I act any different? Well, we've all run traffic lights, right? But if there's a camera at that intersection, you don't run the traffic light anymore. You don't run that red light. Why not? Well, because it's a traffic light. I'm going to get caught. Well, then why were you thinking about running it in the first place? It changes how you act. And so then comes the question, all right, would we even act natural anymore? Would you still do anything malicious to anyone ever again? I highly doubt it. Yes, some people, of course, would, because some people are horrible and can't be saved. But for a lot of us, I think we have the potential to be acting better. The famous line, and I don't know who said it, was that when the classroom is ready, the teacher walks in. I think that if enough people figured this thing out, it turns into the 100th monkey effect, and I don't want to get into that too much, but you can look that up, where all of a sudden it triggers something and whoever it gets the attention of the builders. And then we have to deal with a brand new reality.
Yeah, between the Bible and the Book of Enoch, confirmation, I think there'd be a big change in people's attitudes towards Scripture. Oh, yeah. Two subjects I want to touch before we get into Admiral Byrd. Sure. And one is Polaris, the North Star. Mm-hmm. If we're hurtling through space, how in the world can that stay in one place?
Excellent point. And science and the debunkers will come back and say, well, you're looking at the wrong question, because if the star constellations spin clockwise one way and counterclockwise another way, depending on what hemisphere you're on, that proves you're on a globe. Okay, two things. One, if we're actually in an enclosed system like a planetarium, anything can be faked. Anything. And if it's big enough, you're going to have multiple projection systems. And since you can only be in one place at one time, that wouldn't be too tough to do. That being said, to your question, parallax. Everyone that's listening, remember that word, parallax. You see it every day. And what I mean by that is, if you're driving down the highway, the telephone poles are going by your window on the side very, very quickly. But the houses and the mountains in the distance go by more slowly because they're further away. And it's a relative motion thing. You see all these things, but the difference is fast. Things that are closer move faster going by you as you're traveling, and things farther in the distance seem like they're going they're traveling at the same speed, but since it's so far away, the motion is much more gradual. Well, here's the thing. If we are in space, I'll give your listeners a relative motion concept here. And that is, forget about that the Earth is spinning 1,000 miles an hour on its axis. Forget about that. But what it's also doing, if you believe mainstream science, is it's going around the sun at over 60,000 miles an hour. And that's pretty fast, but it's slow in space terms, if you believe science. No, the real speed is the solar system itself flying like a flattened dinner plate through the galaxy at 500,000 miles an hour, and then our galaxy is traveling through the universe at even greater speeds. So the question is, if our If our solar system is traveling through the galaxy at 500,000 miles an hour, the closest star, if you believe mainstream science, is 4 light years away. But there's some that are thousands of light years away, and there's some that are millions of light years away, if not further. Then why, when we take time-lapse photography of the night sky, why do the star trails always end up in these perfect circular patterns with the North Star not moving at all? Now, science will come back and say, well, that's because the distances are so great that we can't notice. We'll never be able to see the difference in a single time-lapse photography thing. Even during our – you could take it for a whole year. You'd never notice the difference because the distances are so huge, because – the speed of light, if it's 720 million miles an hour, and a light year is, you know, multiply that by every 24 hours a day times 365 days, it's an immense number. So I was like, well, that's fine and all, but, you know, 500,000 miles an hour really adds up over time. And from what we can tell, the constellations have never altered their shape over thousands of years, never altered their shape. And we don't even hear stories of any stars that are in completely different spots now or have moved a significant amount. Why is that? Science has a tough time at trying to answer that question. Say, well, no, the distances are so far that even thousands of years you're not going to see. Let's go, oh, that's a stretch. No play on words there, but it is. Something should have moved. Granted, we can't do a time lapse from 1,000 years ago to now, but I bet you if we did, turn out the same way, which leads us more into the firmament sky dome sort of planetarium scenario, which is everything that's spinning around there now is still spinning around there. And since civilizations don't last that long, from what we can tell, ours has been only going on 5,000 years. By the time we figure it out, chances are we're the ending of our run anyway, and then they start over, which is a whole nother thing, which is that I still don't believe, not for a second, that we are the first civilization to rent this apartment. This world, this enclosed world, is not a one-off, not by a long stretch. There's too many things out there, too many gaps in our history. Things like, Atlantis, the whole theory of Atlantis. Is that city still down there? You think, well, no, Atlantis isn't real. Okay, fine. You don't want to pay attention to Bimini Road. That's fine. What about the sunken cities off of Japan that nobody has any records of? During our history, or the sunken cities off of India, or the real age of the pyramids, or the Bosnian pyramids, or the Mexican pyramids, or all the other pyramids that are going on out there. There's a lot going on that we don't know, but there appears to be previous versions that have lived inside here, going all the way back to the supercontinent of Pangaea, which even scientists will say was real. It's like, okay, who lived on Pangaea during that time? Because we got no record of it. You know, if we're version 7, who was version 654? And, of course, the important question is, who was version 1? Who were the first people here? You know, were they here voluntarily, or were they imprisoned here? But that's a whole other story for another time.
Well, I agree. I think it does, from what I've seen, we may be number 7. But, you know, Genesis 1:1, mm-hmm. Hebrew is actually what it really translates is in a beginning, not in the beginning.
There you go.
Indicating that this is not the first go around. Now, do you think Polaris is in the center of the flat Earth?
Maybe. It's got a shot anyway. I mean, if it is due north of the center of the map, which would be on the disk, if you looked at it like a clock, the place where the hands were in the center, yeah, mm-hmm. Sure.
Yeah. Yeah. I was thinking that too, and then that would mean the dome would be at its highest point at that point.
Yes.
But also, there's information that potentially there's a very large hole up there that leads into the center of the Earth. Is that part of the Hollow Earth, or where does that come from?
Yeah, that's what that's how I got into Flat Earth. Again, nobody goes into Flat Earth because they want to deliberately, as far as I can tell. It's all by accident. People just just accidentally skim into it, open Pandora's box. But that's how I got into it. I was looking into the hollow earth theory. And because I was fascinated with it, the man, I can't remember his name, that wanted to do that expedition to the North Pole some years ago, back in the early 2000s, I think. He'd end up dying of cancer. I completely wanted to be on that, that expedition. But when I was researching the hollow earth, and the hollow earth theory states that the world's still a sphere, but inside the earth it's all hollowed out, and there's another series of civilization or more living inside there. And the story goes that Admiral Byrd, America's greatest explorer and youngest admiral in the United States Navy of all time, that made admiral, he took a rickety plane up there in 1926 and supposedly found the entrance to some cavernous system, and found, turned into a journey to the center of the earth type scenario, where he saw all sorts of interesting and prehistoric things, and things were bigger, and it was a whole nother ecosystem. But you would think that's from his supposed diary things. Now, whether that's true or not, that's fine and all, but it didn't really matter, because he, after 1926, was rerouted to the South Pole in 1928, and that's where he spent the rest of his life, was exploring Antarctica for the better part of 30 years. And it appeared that he was looking for something, looking for whatever it was. And I had no doubt what he was looking for. The powers that be had the old maps, and they said, okay, if the center of the earth, if the North Pole is something, well, then the outer edge has got to be there, right? And it doesn't guarantee, if you found an entrance at the North Pole, it doesn't mean that it's not a sphere. It just means that you got an entrance at the North Pole. So he spends the next 30 years out in Antarctica flying literally, with the exception of World War II, with the only country, you probably know this, maybe you don't, the only country that was down in Antarctica during World War II was
Germany.
Nazi Germany. Mm-hmm. Everyone else was not there, which leads into a whole another thing. So, do you want me to get more into the bird thing?
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Schwabenland and all that. Absolutely.
Okay. Well, before we do that, let me do a quick follow up on the North Pole.
Okay.
There's an interesting side story to the North Pole, and I don't know if it's true, but I really like it because it gives me one of those vibes that it very well could be true, which is there was a second guy that made a trip up there along the same time frame, and his name is Charles Lindbergh. Because he wasn't going to be bested by Admiral Byrd, so he goes up there with his wife and flies up there, does the exact same thing, but he takes pictures, and he comes back supposedly. Again, you can read it up on this. It's an interesting story. It takes a little bit of internet digging, but you'll find it. He takes pictures and he comes back. He says, "This is the greatest find ever. We got to tell everybody." And the United States government comes to him and says, "Yeah, you're not going to tell anybody on this. This is our secret. We have the right." It's like, what are you talking about? The United States. You don't have to. And so, to show him that they were serious, that's when the whole Lindbergh baby thing happened.
Mm.
That it wasn't some random act. It was like, look, you will lose everything. This is just a taste of what we can do. And shortly afterwards, Charles Lindbergh renounced his United States citizenship and left America forever.
Yeah.
So, but anyway, that's a darker whole thing. So, but it was an interesting side story. I go, wow, that's a pretty good one. I like it. So, the Admiral Byrd goes down to Antarctica in 1928, and he's there until at least the early 1940s, because then he starts getting involved in World War II, because he was an admiral after all. He was actually at I think it was Tokyo, wherever they signed the surrender agreement for Japan. He was there. And then he goes down in 1946 and does Operation High Jump down in Antarctica, where he takes a full-blown carrier fleet, the whole nine yards, all the support ships, for no apparent reason whatsoever. Why would you take thousands of men and all these ships, military ships, down there? Up until now, he'd only been doing exploration missions. And the rumor was that he was trying to root out the last of the Nazi bases, the Nazis had actually found something down there, and they stayed. So what, after Germany fell, the remnants of the Nazi war machine were still down there, were still in Antarctica, and Admiral Byrd was going to root them out. Now, there are different stories about this. Nothing's ever been confirmed. But two things we do know. One is, whatever happened down there, the problem was taken care of. And we know this because of the 1954 interview, which I don't know if you watched, where Admiral Byrd went on television on one of the CBS stations. The show was called The Longines Chronoscope. L-O-N-G-I-N-E-S Chronoscope, which was like the 60 minutes of its day, 1954. And by the time he got on that show, whatever happened with the Nazi thing, that potential Nazi thing, was not even an issue anymore, because it was not even, all the countries were down there, and you know, granted, it was 8 years later, but it was taken care of, whatever it was. Now, I'm sorry, the one thing we don't know is, if they did take care of the problem, what happened to the Germans? Because there's all sorts of speculation that they went to war, you know, they had this big skirmish with the Germans had access to advanced weapons, and that, you know, several planes were shot down on the Allied side, blah, blah, blah. There's another side of that story, which I tend to believe more than others, which is that Germany, the remnants of the Nazi Party, supposedly asked, that there was an advanced technology civilization down there, not us, you know, not our civilization, but another civilization, and that they asked this civilization for asylum, and that the civilization, the rules are pretty clear, and they say, okay, fine, you know, you grant asylum, you know, if we grant you asylum, you can come with us, and you can, we'll relocate you. But the condition is, you can never come back. You are, you know, it's like leaving a high school dance. You can't leave and get drunk in the parking lot and come back. That's the same sort of rules that apply here. Either way, doesn't really, I mean, it's a good story, but it's not something I really focus on too much, because either way, by the time Byrd went on national television in 1954, and this is on YouTube, you guys can look it up, it's the interview is still out there in multiple forms. He was talking about Antarctica like it was a gold mine, for lack of a better term. It was resource heavy, made out of money, an entire mountain range made out of coal. There was oil, there was minerals, there was uranium. And when he went on television for this, there were a lot of countries already down there. The United States, the UK, the Soviet Union, Argentina, Chile, New Zealand, Australia. Take your pick. They're all down there, and he's getting ready. This is 54. He's getting ready for what turned out to be his last mission, Operation Deep Freeze, in 55 to 56. He ended up dying of a mysterious heart attack in 1957. Even they say, oh, well, he died at his home in a chair. It's like, oh, whatever. You know, that guy was the model of health. You can't tell me he just died for no reason. This is a guy that should have died in the snow, you know, buried under 1,000 feet of ice. But that didn't happen. So he goes back down there in 1955, 1956 for this Operation Deep Freeze, which wasn't a military operation from what I can tell. And during that mission was when he found something, or they found something. In fact, it could have been the Russians first, it could have been the United States, but I think in 1954 they had given up looking, because if the best explorer in the world can't find what you're looking for, meaning the edge of the world, for lack of a better term, if they can't find it in 30 years, well, then it's probably not even there. And that's Murphy's Law, of course. So he goes on television and says, oh, well, all the companies should just start carving this place up. And then 1956, he finds something. And then almost immediately, that's when the world changed. Meaning the powers that be found something that spooked them so bad, they developed a zero tolerance policy and decided to shut off all the edges of the world at the same time. And people don't understand usually when I say that. So let me put it this way. If you found, because I had to really extrapolate a lot of different theories when I was looking at this. And one of them was, if you did figure out that the Earth was not a sphere, you would have, how would you hide the world from the general public? How would you keep that secret going? And one of the first things you would do is you would completely seal off the boundaries in a way that would not scare the public, but keep them out of range. And so two things happened very, very quickly. One was the NASA was formed in 1958, but 1959, this is the big one, 1959, the Van Allen radiation belts were announced that says that, oh, by the way, if you go up really, really high with anything, you're going to die because there's a huge band of radiation up there. People can't ever go through it. That was announced by NASA themselves a year after NASA was formed. But the second thing that happened, which was much more subdued, was the 1959 Antarctic Treaty, which says in so many words that no corporation from any country in the world can go down there and do anything ever. So let's say you created your own country called Scottastic or something, and this country became an economic power. You would have a treaty put in front of you and you would have to sign this. And it says, well, what does this say? It says, none of your corporations can go down to Antarctica. You say, how long is it in effect? Well, it's not even up for review until the year 2041, but basically it's ever because it's just going to get renewed in 2041. Nobody gets to go there. And that was one of those big aha moments as far as you want to look for some suspicious stuff, stuff that you can put in a courtroom case that makes people start squinting at you. It's stuff like this. Everyone knows the world is based on money and power and greed. Well, what's bigger than that? If you're in the United States, you know full well that if a petroleum company wanted to start fracking in your backyard tomorrow, they could probably pull it off. It's only a question of how many people they can bribe. So why don't these same companies, even though we already know there's oil supposedly down there, why aren't they allowed to go down there? And furthermore, why are they not allowed to even talk about it? That's the big one. And that is, as you know, politicking and lobbying, their lobbyists make a huge amount of money and they pay a lot of money. If you're the head of Exxon Oil, how hard would it be to call somebody up at the New York Times and say, I want to run a full page ad once a month saying how great it would be for our country to go into, how many jobs it would create for our company to go to Antarctica. They're not allowed to even do that. There's a wall of silence built around at the highest level. And I'm sure, you know, the Exxon execs don't know anything. They're just, if they even thought about doing it, the government who monitors the phone calls and the emails and the regular mails, the correspondence, they probably say, look, it's national security. It's above your pay grade. You don't get to know. But furthermore, it's the only treaty ever in the history of treaties, of all treaties ever, that has been ratified unilaterally by every country. China doesn't have a problem with this. What about the Soviet Union? They were rebuilding after World War II. They were decimated. UK, they were rebuilding after World War II. They could have used some of those resources. And this was back when oil was cheap and coal was cheap. Nowadays, that stuff is very, very pricey, especially stuff like uranium and all the minerals. It's amazing that those things would happen. Anyway, the Admiral Byrd story ended, you know, kind of anticlimactically, which was after that, I think that being that he had already done the press tours and gone around the nation, I don't think they could trust him. Yeah. He was proud and like, well, can we trust him, keep his mouth shut? And the authority does not take chances. And they said, let's just have him die quietly at home. He'll be a national hero and we won't ever have to deal with it again. And that was it.
I think his son died not too much after that. And I understand his diary and some other things were sequestered.
Yeah.
So that makes sense. Do you think that since there's an opening in the North Pole, do you think there was also a counter hole down in Antarctica? Now, when I say that, now, as I looked at some of the maps, people are still trying to use the globe theory with an opening in the top and an opening in the bottom.
Sure, sure, sure.
Now, and from what I've seen, Antarctica actually surrounds us and is not a separate continent. Is that the way you
yeah,
understand it?
Yeah, It is no different than looking at the UN flag. If you took a globe and you put your hand on the North Pole and flattened it, and then trimmed the edges so it became a circle, although it doesn't have to be a perfect circle, who knows what the outer edge exactly looks like, then that's what this place looks like. Every other country kind of looks more or less like it does on a globe. I'm sorry, every other country, every other continent. The only thing that doesn't look like a globe is Antarctica. So we think of Antarctica right now as being this island continent, sort of like Australia. And actually, they're fairly similar in size, if you believe mainstream science. But on a flat model, that can't be. There's got to be an outer edge, in which case Antarctica is stretched along the outside, and Antarctica is way bigger than we think it is. It's really a ring continent that's thousands of miles deep. So, and of course, Antarctica is such an unusual continent anyway, because there's so much negative reinforcement tied to it. There's no other continent like it. When you get to Antarctica, the coastline is basically a 150, 200-foot wall of ice straight up, if you can find any ground at all. When you get on top of it starts sloping up almost immediately to about 14,000 feet, which is not good because altitude sickness starts kicking in at about half that, 7,000 feet. And there's no animal life. No indigenous animal life, no plant life, no resources of any kind, so, with the exception of the penguins on the coastline. And that's it. When you go inside for the longest time, it just screams, go away. And it is the great natural reinforce, I'm sorry, great negative reinforcement to keep people from going there up until recently. So if you had a wooden ship, icebergs start forming in Iowa is at 15 degrees Fahrenheit, and down there it's way colder. And so if the icebergs don't turn you away, the coastline will, because you're not going to be able to scale it. If you can get on top of the coastline, well, hopefully you packed a lunch, because there's nothing for you to set up camp with. So literally until the Industrial Revolution happened, until the internal combustion happened, there was nothing you could do in Antarctica. And that, of course, once the engine was created, that's where our main focus has been. Although even today, there's some scientific organizations down there, and you of course you have people will say, well, no, I can book a trip to Antarctica right now. I go, yeah, you can spend about $10,000-$15,000 and go to the outer islands and have your picture taken with penguins. But that's all you're going to be able to do. You cannot go inside. Now, of course, there's not going to be signs saying if you go past this point, you'll be shot, because we are suckers for that. It's like, what's past the fence? People will start whispering. We've learned a little bit since Area 51, but you will not be able to just go. You need permits to go into the interior. If you want to go to what supposedly is the South Pole, there will be guides that will take you. But the rest of it, there's an invisible line out there you cannot cross. They will watch you every step of the way. And here's the big thing here. The reason why the corporations are not down there is because sooner or later, as the technology gets advanced enough for the corporation, better helicopters, better planes, someone's going to stray off course, either deliberately or accidentally. And if they stray too close to it, and have a chance of seeing something they're not supposed to. And I don't know what that is. Is it a barrier? Is it frost giants? Is it an opening? Don't know. But whatever it is, it's big enough and scary enough that they didn't want to take any chances, because if you did see it in your private plane or your oil company helicopter, you would have to be dealt with. And they don't want to deal with it. They said, you know what? We're gonna seal this thing down. We're gonna lock it down to where we don't have to deal with it. We don't ever have to worry about an oil company. Otherwise, we're going to have to spend all this time and energy. And plus, especially if it's an oil company or a mining company, they're going to keep encroaching, going to keep moving in, keep moving in, keep moving in. And sooner or later, you're going to have to stop them. How's that conversation work? How do you go to a mineral company and say, oh, yeah, by the way, you can't go past this line? You can't go past this latitude. And they say, well, why not? It's like, well, it's national security. How many times can you use that line? Is it before all of a sudden people hate that? So they decide, you know what? We're going to seal it off. We'll call it environmental, scientific issues, and that's it. And it's worked brilliantly up until now. And now it's been noticed, and so they're scrambling. They don't know what to do.
Yeah, I noticed that the Mariana Trench, Bush, when he was in office, Bush Jr., he made that off limits, and I'm sure there's some connection there. Say, sure. then Operation Fishbowl came along. Mm-hmm. You want to talk about that?
Sure. Operation Fishbowl. Well, even before that. So remember when I said if you're trying to hide the world, there's a couple things you'd want to do. If you figured it out in 1956, the first thing you're going to have to do is you got to figure out how much of the world you have to hide. Meaning if it is a snow globe, well, you don't know the boundaries of it. All you know is you reached one edge of it. You don't even know how big or tall or how vast this thing is. So that was one of the first things I looked at, which was, okay, how do you map it with the technology of the day? And the first thing that they did was they immediately started the United States and Soviet Union, because they were the only ones with nuclear, and I have to stop myself from saying nuclear because the Americans screwed that up in my vocabulary. They started firing nuclear weapons straight up for 4 years, starting in 1958 all the way until 1962. And it's very, very interesting because the first three shots that were used were megaton weapons. And megaton weapons back in the 1950s, that was unheard of. You know, that was very rare, very expensive. And you're not going to test those in the ground. You're not going to test those in the water. You're going to test those on a blank part of the sky. And you look at those first three shots, and I believe what they were trying to do, because, again, I can only go what I would do is if you can't break through, again, there's your male impulse right there. It's like, there's a wall, let's see if we can bust through it. What do you got? Cannons? No. All right, let's try, you know, atomic weapons. So the first three shots didn't work, and then immediately NASA was formed after that third shot. It was like okay, we're gonna start firing, and then we're gonna have to militarize the sky. So NASA's military, you know, becomes a viable thing as the weapons are being shot. And one of the packages, the Russians name their stuff completely different than we do. One of the packages, the series of weapons that were launched on the United States side, was called Operation Fishbowl. Horrible name if you were trying to keep this thing a secret. Although maybe they did that deliberately, just because back then people, anybody else wouldn't have figured it out. You know, the internet is much more clever at deciphering the subtle stuff now. So they're both firing, you know, the megaton weapons were used, and then after that, once they figured out they couldn't get through it, well, they just kept firing, and it looked like they were painting the sky, meaning it's a great way, if you use kiloton weapons, to figure out at least where the curvatures are, where how high you can go before you run into something. And they were basically defining the structure of the enclosure, the snow globe. And they did it for 4 years, and then the United States and Russia stopped exactly on the same day in 1962. And ever since then, they didn't really do much aerial-wise. They moved it back to island testing and underground testing, but they never did any more stuff in the sky. And the reason why I think they did well, they did it was twofold. One, you know, you try to see if you can breach it, whatever it is, you know, whatever that is, makes the substance that makes up the barrier. And two, you need to know how exactly high you have to send your rockets before you have to curve them over. Because if you're going to fake a space program, you can't just send rockets up without knowing exactly where those rockets are going to go. And you don't want them running into things, because people take notice to that. You start wiping out a bunch of rockets that look good on the pad and look good going up, and as long as, hey, it got up to 400, 500 miles and just disintegrated. What the heck, right? You can only do that so many times before people will start to put things together. So that's what has led into the space program. Again, you guys can look this up. None of this stuff is secret information. Is that every rocket that's ever been fired goes vertically for a short distance, usually slightly out of normal visual range, and then it starts rolling over and the rocket goes horizontal. It just goes out into the ocean and ditches. That's all they ever do. I mean, we all know the boosters automatically go out into the ocean, because NASA will tell you that. It's like, oh no, we've designed the boosters to where they go to this spot in the ocean, which happens to be like one of the most remote spots from any landmass, this space junk graveyard, apparently. But all the rockets go out there. And there's nothing. There's no, again, I don't want to get too far into it, but I don't have that much time left, which is no astronaut's been in the top of any rocket, because that's the last thing you'd ever want to do. You're not going to put a human being on the top of a pile of liquid explosives and then hope everything goes well, even if you're trying to fake it. So you let the rocket go up, you take the astronaut footage, you dig that up and create it from somewhere else, and then you stitch the two together and ta-da, you got a space program. It's pretty easy, and you can fake it for quite a while. But sooner or later, especially what happened recently, is the internet detection ability has gotten much, much better. Who knew that years, you know, decades later, there'd be people sitting in front of high resolution monitors going through every photograph, every video, and analyzing every frame. And you say, well, what does that matter? It's like, well, we find mistakes. We love finding mistakes. We human beings love a mystery. And there's even with mainstream movies, there's how many websites are out there, like moviemistakes.com? There are geeks out there that will literally go through every movie you've ever heard of, go frame by frame, and see the movie mistakes. You say, what movie mistakes? Well, movies are shot out of sequence to save money. Even Lord of the Rings and Titanic, and they shoot things out of sequence to save money. So if a coffee cup moves from one side of the room to another side of the room without the actor moving it during a scene, they're going to call you on it. And that applies doubly up until now, that people have really just been focused on entertainment. But then they started focusing on the news, stuff that the news has been releasing, and people are starting to find the inconsistencies. It's like, wait, this shouldn't happen. If it's a real live event, everything's happening in real time, there should be no errors. And there's always errors. And with a space program, there's massive errors, huge amounts. Even recently, I'm sorry, I'm going off on a rant here, but the Super Bowl, which just happened, right? They had an astronaut thing where they were showing the astronauts. One was in Atlanta Falcons jersey, and one was in the New England Patriots jersey. Well, how did that work exactly? Because the last rocket that was shot up there was just during the beginning of the playoffs. So unless they took every single jersey up there, how did they know who was going to win the Super Bowl unless they won it? And now, of course, you can say, well, they did take every jersey up there. I'm going, okay, if you believe in the costs associated with it, that's between $10,000 and $30,000 a pound. You really think the NFL is going to front that sort of cash just to do a short little shot with two people in jerseys? I don't buy it. But anyway, that's a whole other thing.
I know that there's been past explorers that have tried to find inroads, entrances, endings, and they went thousands and thousands of miles and never found that. Yeah. What's interesting, though, you know, on this fishbowl, that I understand there was a confrontation with UFOs. There was something that went on. There were ships that were lost, men that were killed. Was that in association with them nuking, or was that a different incident? Do you know?
It's hard to say, because I didn't run into it on Fishbowl, but it wouldn't necessarily surprise me. But it segues into something which should be addressed, because lots of people will say, especially in the conspiracy world, well, what about UFOs? Are you saying that UFOs don't exist? I'm saying, no, not at all. I'm saying that the UFOs definitely exist. I've watched a whole ton of them with night vision binoculars. You want to have some fun. You guys, anyone that's serious about looking at UFOs, pick up a pair of night vision binoculars, 5 power or better, and start looking on a clear sky and what's up there. There's a lot of weird stuff. You won't believe how many things. The sky is just crawling with stuff. But are these things that are up there, are they from Mars and Jupiter and Venus and so on? No, they're not. They're probably much, much closer. And much, in fact, there's two schools of thought. One, that they have the ability to enter and leave the structure at will, or they're stuck in here with us. You know, I still think a lot of them are previous remnants of older civilizations that have been in here with us. And I'll even go so far as to say that let me change this up. Could they be the janitors? Could they be the superintendents? Yes. But for whatever reason, they have rules to follow. And with rules comes structure. And AI, of course, everyone's, you know, talks about Roswell. Oh, Roswell, right? No. Don't get past Roswell. There are bigger things than Roswell out there. Look up the 1899 Aurora, Texas incident. Or my personal favorite, which I think everyone that's into UFOs should memorize, and that is the 1561 Nuremberg event, which is has its own wiki entry. It's so big. Which is that a giant armada on an clear April day above Germany, Nuremberg, Germany, two big groups of ships duked it out over the skies of Germany. And they fought each other for a full-blown hour. Two definitely defined factions, one with using ships that looked like discs, the other looking ships that looks like winged craft. And they fought long enough that people were sitting down there eating their schnitzelgluben and toast or whatever they ate for breakfast. And the sketch artist came out and sketched the whole thing and put it on their newspaper. And even Ancient Aliens covered it in one of their shows. But what's interesting, the Ancient Aliens left this out, and I know why, is that after an hour, the reason why the whole thing broke up is a third faction showed up in a single giant angular black craft, pulled in right between them, and those guys bugged out. And the reason why the Ancient Aliens didn't bring it up, and the reason why you don't hear about this incident very much, even though you can even read the newspaper yourself, it's on Wiki, is that the whole incident raises questions about protocols and how this whole place was put together. Meaning, let's see, five questions that come up just because of this incident. All right, who were these two factions? Why were they fighting over a major city in Germany? Who was the third faction? Why do they? Were they the cops? Were they the UN? Why did the other groups, not engage these guys? And why did they run away so quickly? Why did it take the black ship an hour to get there? What sort of response time is that? Where did they come from exactly? And then, of course, what are the rules? Meaning, obviously, those two groups shouldn't have been there. So why? It's such a great story because it starts to break down the question of the argument that people will throw out at UFO people and say, well, if there are UFOs, why has one never landed on the White House lawn? And the answer is, now I know, is, well, because there are rules to follow. You can't just show up in Main Street anywhere USA and land your ship, come out, take pictures, sign a few autographs, and take off. You can't do that because you would severely influence the population. Remember, it's all about keeping them acting normally. So I'm sorry, that's my little rant. But anyone wants to have fun, if you're a UFO guy at all, whoever you are, look up the 1561 Nuremberg event. It'll blow your mind.
Okay. Before we've got plenty of time here, but I want to definitely touch on, if we're under a dome, where are meteors coming from?
Good one. Meteors don't have to be, remember, how shall I phrase this? If one part of the system is artificial, then all of it is artificial. So that means everything from the jet stream in the upper atmosphere to the underwater conveyor system to the magma system. Meteors, fairly easy by comparison. Just take a piece of metal ore, inject it into the system at speed, let the atmosphere superheat it with friction, try not to aim at any major cities, which is also interesting. Why is a meteor or comet or whatever, we see craters every once in a while, some big ones, but we never see even the smallest meteor hit a populated area. Never happens. You think as the population grows, that we might run into these. We don't. But do I think meteors are artificial? Yes. I had a friend once tell me, it's like, he goes, well, maybe it's kind of like throwing a rock into an aquarium. Like, yeah, maybe. Could it be automated? Could it be manual? Don't know. I would like to think that it's more automated, and but at the same time, that one that came down and exploded over Russia a few years ago, that seemed a little close.
Absolutely. The other question would be on eclipse, the fact, whether we believe that things rotate around or whether they're just circular on the flat. How do we explain eclipse compared to the moon, sun and moon?
Sure. This is not hard to do even in a flat model because the sun and the moon are physical objects. Again, interesting, the sun and the moon is 400 times less diameter than the sun, but it's also 400 times closer. That's a wonderful coincidence. So it fits perfectly in front of the sun. And people say, well, you know, no, the sun's 93 million miles away. But it's, again, because the moon is, again, that 400, it's awfully coincidental. But if you want to look at other coincidental things of the moon, the first one you gotta look at would obviously be the moon's face that shows itself to us is perfectly aligned with the Earth's rotation, meaning we see exactly the same side of the moon. Not even a half a degree a year does it change one way or the other. It never wavers. Nothing ever changes it. And statistically, that's a nightmare, because you can't tell me it's completely locked in for all time. You know, 1,000 years go by and we always see the same side of the moon. Not buying it. But anyway, the short answer to that is the moon is just a physical object, and it travels in front of the sun. And you know, whatever light system they use to create the eclipse, it seems to work out pretty well.
So Aurora Borealis, do you think it originates out of the hole in the north or what?
Sure, why not? It's possible. It's a great, and then science can cover it later and say that it's just the solar winds blowing over the top of our world. So why not? It's now, if you do have a severely advanced technology, I would imagine you try to find a way to cloak it. Don't know. No, not exactly. It's sure. If it is, then great. If not, I'm not going to be too upset about it.
Yeah. What about flat Earth maps?
As far as what they look like?
Well, there's been ancient maps, and they've fit fairly close to one that was recent, and I don't remember how long ago.
Right. The flat Earth maps was interesting. When I did one of the clues, it was called the Map Makers. It was one of those weird connections that I was making. Now, granted, it was a little bit of a leap of faith, but I think it worked out quite well, which was when I was looking at the wiki list of map projections of the world. You go through all these map projections, there's all sorts of diamonds and weird oval shapes and semicircles and crap like that. But you run into one called the Azimuthal Equidistant Map, which is A-Z-I-M-U-T-H-A-L, equidistant. And it's the only map in the entire list that has these weird notations next to it, and multiple notations. One, that it was created, the perspective was created by a thousand years ago by a Persian scientist named Al-Biruni, which I thought was fascinating. I was like, okay, who the heck is Al-Biruni? And NASA actually named a moon crater after Al-Biruni. It's like, okay, why would you name a moon crater if this guy, you know, granted, science doesn't, you know, looks past countries' borders, and if he's Iranian, Iran. But it was very, very interesting. But two, the USGS, the United States Geological Survey, they also use that map in their projections. And the third was that, the most interesting was that same projection used by these two things was also used by the UN flag. That is what the UN uses as their banner for the world. So when you're looking at the UN flag, which shows a top-down view of the world with the North Pole in the very center of the circle, that is where it comes from. Interesting, though, and I won't take credit for discovering this, was that there's something missing on the UN flag. And I'm sure you know what it is.
Antarctica.
Mm-hmm. Antarctica is not there. It is not on the UN flag. And instead, you've got these two sets of Greco-Roman spiky wreaths on the outside of it. Very interesting that Antarctica would be left off that map, kind of like out of sight, out of mind. You say, well, no, Antarctica can't be on there because of how the perspective is, like, which is why I included in some of my slideshows different views. You can totally build a flag, a UN flag, based on the world without excluding Antarctica. It is easily done. But they chose a perspective that where it's gone instead of, and maybe in their case it's like, okay, well, we can't paint Antarctica as this giant ice ring, even though the azimuthal map clearly shows it as an ice ring if you look at that perspective. We'll just kind of just dismiss it and we won't tell anybody about it. Also interesting, of course, is that I believe that flag was finished in 1946, the same year as, or real close to it, the same year as Operation Deep Freeze. I'm sorry, Operation High Jump.
So if we talked about the moon and stars and we tried to figure out what stars are, what do you think they are?
I think they're no different than what they are in a planetarium. I think they are points of light. Now, they may be way more advanced than what we do in the average run-of-the-mill planetarium. And if you guys haven't been to a planetarium recently, I highly encourage that you go. It'll give you way better perspective on what I'm talking about. But I think that they're, I mean, they could be two-dimensional, they could be three-dimensional, but from what I can tell, they are points of light. Nothing different. You zoom in with your telescope, they're just super fuzzy points of light. And every now, of course, there are some people that say, well, I've seen the rings of Jupiter and, you know, Jupiter's moons. Like, yeah, you may have seen Jupiter's moon, but they're still just fuzzy points of light. The only clear shots you ever see of anything that's supposedly outside of our world are from one group, and then that's NASA. They're the only ones that show you the high-res pictures, and you combine that with you looking in the night sky, and you say, oh, that's a fuzzy red dot. I think that's Mars. You remember the Mars photos from your textbooks, and there you go, a compound memory that works extremely well at reinforcing the solar system model.
What about the Coriolis effect? Is it really, truly a fact, or what's going
doesn't
on?
Doesn't exist, not even close to what we define it as. And I'll have an example. Okay, I'll give you two really good examples. One would be the myth that the toilets and the sinks run in opposite directions depending on if you're in the northern or southern hemisphere. And there is a great YouTube channel. He is not a flat earther, but he is one of the biggest YouTube channels out there called Smarter Every Day. He's got like 4 or 5 million subscribers. He's huge. And he set out and did a simultaneous real-time streaming feed where he toilets or sinks, he took two big kids' wading pools, put a singular manufactured, you know, did a drain in the center, filled them up very high, and he had one guy in the southern hemisphere, one guy and him in the northern hemisphere, and simultaneously they hit the drain plugs, right, after letting the water sit for hours and hours, so it was perfectly still. And to make sure the water was not disturbed, instead of putting like a rubber ducky or whatever it is in the water to see which way it would go, he used an eyedropper with food coloring to make sure, you know, in a cross pattern on this big kid's wading pool to see exactly which way the water went. And it was the most gradual clockwise and or counterclockwise you could ever ask for. It was almost non-existent. And he'd be the first one to tell you, like, look, it does not, you know, whatever effect it has on water doesn't exist. That being said, the people that have called into, because I have my own little radio show on Truth Frequency, and I had a bunch of people contacting me unsolicited, especially from the military, people that were shooting artillery, shooting missiles, shooting torpedoes. Bullets, that's nothing. Bullets, that's a mile. Artillery goes 20 miles. Missiles go 60 miles. And they all said the same thing. They go, we do not take Coriolis effect into the firing solution. We don't do it. Because if we did, you'd be constantly having to figure out where you were in the world. Let's say you drove 200 miles north and then started engaging a target. What exactly... you change your Coriolis effect accordingly. And they all said the same thing. It doesn't happen. Now, to that effect, though, they said that we've all heard about it. And you might even see a glimpse of it in a manual somewhere, but nobody actually uses it for practical purposes. So, no, the Coriolis effect, otherwise known as the Earth spinning, does not happen. And this shouldn't surprise anybody because, for example, look at the water. Everyone knows that if you're driving in a car, you can't with a cup of coffee in one hand, you can't take a corner too sharp left or right, because the physics is going to knock that water around in your coffee cup. So if the world is actually spinning 1,000 miles an hour at the equator and 0 miles an hour at the North Pole or South Pole, remember that it's like a merry-go-round, right? So if you're in a merry-go-round, you're on the edge, it's trying to throw you off. But if you're in the middle of the merry-go-round, it's smooth sailing. There's nothing ever happening there, right? So if the water is on a globe, is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour, and I don't care how gradual it is, fine, you know, it's still 1,000 miles an hour. It's like, well, it takes 24 hours to go around. I go, still 1,000 miles an hour. Why is there water at the North and South Pole, and why isn't it starting to pool up towards the equator? I'm not saying it doesn't have to be completely pooled up, but there's going to be a bulge there, and you're going to be able to see it. It's going to be very noticeable. You know, not like the rings of Saturn where the water is going to be spinning around the world, but it should be there, and it's not. Explain to me how gravity is holding the water perfectly to the surface of the world without any bulges, even though centrifugal force says that the water should be pooling. It doesn't happen.
Yeah, I've noticed the centrifuge you were talking about, and also for curvatures, there doesn't seem to be any correction factors in manufacturing of bridges and so forth. And everything I've found, there is nothing to prove curvature, especially when you look at the ocean waters or that particular long canal that was in London or somewhere in that area.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so...
Take your pick, the Suez Canal.
Yeah.
Heck, let's go back to the Roman aqueduct system where they didn't even know about curvature. How the heck did they build that? If there was curvature, that aqueduct system wouldn't work and they'd never be able to figure out why it wasn't working. They'd be stuck. They'd be stumped. And this was something I didn't even really get into with the clues. When I did the clues, we were still just kind of reaching around in the dark in some cases, and people came and said, look, there may not be curvature at all. I initially thought there might be a less curve, you know, like I was going with Orlando Ferguson's flattened stationary earth model where there was some sort of curvature. But in everything that I've seen to date, we can't find curvature at all. And I'm sure you've talked about the 8 inches per mile squared. But it has to be repeated. Look, 8 inches per mile squared means that the curvature, eventually you're going to be looking over the other side of a hill, and we never see it. So one of the first guests I had on my show was a naval missile instructor who said, look, we're painting targets ship to ship at 50 nautical miles, which is about 60 land miles. We'll just call it 60 miles. Won't confuse people. And we're going with a 2-inch beam radar. We're hitting ship to ship. We're not bouncing off anything. We're not painting the sky and going down. We can see these targets at 60 miles, and we have to have that for the missile to work. How are we hitting the targets at 60 miles if there's a curvature of the Earth? 60 miles is several thousand feet of curvature. That ship should not even be remotely visible, let alone targetable. And every instance that is the same, to where now I'm coming at science, I'm saying, okay, find me an object on the other side of a body of water that we can't see anywhere. Find me an object, a lighthouse, a building, something that where no matter how, what weather conditions, you know, whatever clear day or whatever day you can think of, that we can't see it. You can always see it, and it should always be impossible. The Chicago skyline, a great example. Several thousand feet of curvature. Yes, there's some atmospheric lensing. Yes, there's some distortion, but you can see it. Mm-hmm. It's right there. The sun will set behind it. You can see the buildings. There's an island off of Hawaii that's pushing 100 miles. There's another one off in Europe, 150 miles. The only limits we have right now are the atmosphere itself, because as you know, because people say, why can't, and I have to throw this in there, why can't you see New York from wherever, someplace in Europe, whatever the western edge of Europe is? And it's like, well, you can't because of the atmosphere, because you're not looking through a vacuum. You're looking through what's really a thin version of water. But a lot of people don't even know. It's like, look, you're only breathing 20% oxygen. The rest of it's nitrogen. Yeah, of course, there's some trace gases, but it's still 80%, 20% more or less. Mm-hmm. Because of that, you're looking through kind of a soup, and you're only going to be able to see so far, kind of like when you're underwater. You can only see so far before it starts getting hazy. Now, if it was a vacuum, then you could see way, way farther. And I got a funny feeling that, yes, you probably could, if it was a vacuum, see incredible distances. But you can't, and I think that was part of the reinforcement system that was built in to limit our vision.
Yeah, when I was studying radio theory, they were trying to tell me that the line of sight for radio was 17 miles on the ocean, and obviously that's not the case.
No.
Now, with all the people who are already in as flat earthers, their websites, everything that they're generating out there, are they all on the same page, or is there even disagreements amongst flat earthers?
Oh, yeah, there's dissension in the ranks for sure. But most of it is because we don't have an organized front against us from science, because there's too many questions they can't deal with. So right now there's two camps, really. And that is it flat with a dome over it, or is it just flat and there's just a whole bunch of more land on the outside? And of course there's some hybrid people who say, well, there could be other continents on the outside, or maybe there's more domes and we're not just one, and it's not just a one-off and we're part of a big snow globe collection, we don't know. But yeah, there is some dissension in the ranks, and it has been there since day one, like with anything, because there's so much enthusiasm and excitement regarding the field itself. People get really charged up about this.
Yeah.
So, and they don't know what to do. And a lot of people want to take, men don't like sharing spotlights and power. And so some of the early guys are like, no, this is totally mine. It's like, look, nobody in this new community created Flat Earth. Flat Earth was there a long, long, long time ago. But the resurgence of it has been a community effort. Even I'll be the first one to tell you, like, fine, I made a dummy's guide to Flat Earth, but the real research, the real details has been done by other people. I gave sort of a framework for people to delve into, but some amazing channels. Even my YouTube channel is not even in the top 10 in terms of subscribers, as far as the people in the community. There's lots of people out there doing fantastic work. And I'm just humbled to be a part of it right now.
Well, with my experience with interdimensional beings, otherwise known as demons, and what I do for casting them out, and the potential of different realms, do you think we're in a matrix, we're in a holodeck, or what do you think?
It's very possible, of course, because when you start breaking down the whole matter energy conversion stuff and frequency harmonics, and of course it is. For several reasons. One is that we're aspiring to create that sort of thing now. We're trying to create the holodecks. We're trying to create the matrix. I don't think, however, that the rules of this world will allow it. Meaning, if you've ever seen the movie that was a year before The Matrix called The 13th Floor.
Yes, I did see that. Mm-hmm.
Which was, of course, based on the German movie in 1975 called World on a Wire, which was based on Simulcron 3, which was a book in the 1960s. And the idea behind it, though, was very simple. And that is, when you create a virtual reality that you could go into and hang out in, and if it was undistinguishable from the world that you were in, again, hence the Matrix references, how do you know when you got out of it and you went back to your real world that even that wasn't another level of the Matrix?
Yeah.
And you don't know. You don't. You can, because again, the Morpheus line, what if you were in a dream? If the dream was so real, how would you wake up from that dream? You don't know, because you don't know the boundaries of the dream. So it's very, very possible, though. I have always wondered that, and it makes sense in some ways, because some people have described this dome as sitting on like a square footing, a square foundation. I thought, well, that's very interesting, because the holodeck, which was different from the Truman Show. The Truman Show was this domed structure, this circular domed structure. But the holodeck was just a big square box. That's all it was. And you're thinking, why would it be a square box? What's that got to do with anything? Because computers don't like thinking in anything but right angles. They don't like circles. Computers don't know how to draw circles. We can draw circles. It's just something we're born with, but computers don't know how to draw circles. If you zoom in on a computer drawing a circle, they're just making tiny, tiny, tiny right angles that can't be determined from the naked eye of being a curve. And so a holodeck would be square, and any sort of simulation would be a giant square building, because it's easier to do. Hell, The video game stuff, because I used to play video games for a living, the simulations that we're making now are big square. The construct is inside a giant square room, and the worlds are perfectly flat, by the way. When you're playing a video game, you don't notice it. Doesn't matter how big the world is, it's always a flat world. Now, of course, there's some games that go out of their way to try to make spheres, but you're saying, okay, what's your point? My point is they're all flat and they're all square because from a programming standpoint, it's easier. I'm not saying that God is lazy. I'm saying that God is very efficient. You don't create a whole, you don't make a whole bunch of extra effort for yourself if you don't need it. I'll throw in one more thing, which is when it comes to space, because a lot of people say, well, isn't there space? Is there space outside of this? I'm going, you're still hanging on to the original idea. If everyone believes there's space, if the illusion of space is bought, if it is soaked in by 99.9% of the people, then you don't have to build space. You don't have to have a solar system if everyone believes there's a solar system. All you have to have is a room that simulates a solar system. So no different than a planetarium, where people go in and they look at the sky. It's like, are you really in a night, when you lay down in a planetarium, are you really looking at a night sky? Is that really a crescent moon? No, you're in a planetarium. So who's to say that when you walk outside, you're not in a bigger planetarium? And people say, well, no, the spheres. If everything else is spherical, why aren't we spherical? And I go, who told you that they were all spherical? The same guys that told you the Americans went to the moon, those guys? The US government, more specifically the US military? Because NASA's part of the DOD. And if you believe everything they tell you need to read a few more interesting books.
Yeah, I know that pixels would be the term to use how computers would generate that. I know
Yes.
that when it comes to 3D, in between the pixels of the colors, they would have a 255 grayscale, and that's what gives it dimension.
Sure.
As I close out here, I'm sure people are probably worrying about airplane flights, how the FAA controls everything. What do you think's going on with that? That must be one heck of a computer system.
Well, the pilots don't actually know anything. That's the good part. So anyone that has a friend that's a pilot, they're off the hook because the pilots I've talked to, they all do the same thing nowadays, and they all rely on, guess what, the GPS system, otherwise known as the global positioning system, which was built by the DOD, the United States Department of Defense, back in the 90s. And supposedly it has a whole bunch of satellites out there, and they tell you where to go. But there's a catch, and that is when you get to a certain point, if, especially if you're flying over water, your plane disappears in the terms that radar isn't tracking it anymore. And up until who knows if it changes recently or they're going to fake it recently. But what I found was that the latitude and longitude coordinates disappear. They actually go blank and they get replaced with approximated or estimated mode. And that stays that way until you get within radar range of your destination or coastline. Then your plane is picked up and then you're back in it. But the FAA doesn't have to do anything super special because the pilots, all they care about is getting from point A to point B. And they've all said the same thing. It's like, look, as long as we land with our passengers, we trust in the system. They never had to look. So even though the pilots, when they look in the horizon and it looks absolutely flat, no matter what altitude they go to, they won't question it, but at least publicly, because they got their job done. And now privately, they may question it, but they, of course, you can't. You cannot go, you can't remain a pilot in the commercial industry and still believe in a flat earth, because the people, the industry, you really, would you fly with a guy who thinks he's flat? Probably not. So.
I would imagine that there's probably a no-fly over those areas of the Antarctic. Do you know anything about that?
Oh yeah. You're not going anywhere near it. The no plane, no commercial air flights. Look, you can even check this out for yourself. There's plenty of public plane trackers out there. There's FlightAware, there's Plane Tracker, there's Plane Finder, probably more that have been introduced now. They all, of course, get their data from the same DoD system. It's all being piped in from the U.S. military. But you, no flights go to Antarctica. They don't, with the exception of the occasional private military plane that drops people off at the science station. The commercial flights are not allowed to fly over there, even though on a globe it's the shortest distance between two points in the southern hemisphere. They're not allowed to fly over it. And there's various reasons you will find online. They'll say, whoa, it's too cold, or there's an ozone problem, or there's a flight restriction because a plane went down in the 70s. They're just, nobody has the same answer. They're all just... Yeah, they're all making up stuff. It's the Antarctic is a sealed off area. It is a no-go zone.
Yeah. I wanted to answer this. Someone was asking about EME. I'm an amateur radio operator. I hold an extra class license. Mm-hmm. And this is called Earth, Moon, Earth, where we're actually able to use UHF to transmit up to the moon and reflect it back. That is a task that is used by a lot of amateur radio operators. And I just wanted to answer that regardless of whatever the moon is, apparently it does reflect radio waves because that is a phenomenon that does happen.
Sure.
And you track it. The other question was, too, about the jet stream. But again, you know, we don't say the Earth moves at 1,000 miles an hour. It is fixed. Everything above us, that is the sun, the moon, that's what's rotating around or going in the circular motion. That was the question there.
Yeah.
So as we close out here, obviously this is a huge conspiracy. Do you think this is God's doing this? Do you think the Illuminati? What do you think?
No. I think it's God's. Well, I won't say God's conspiracy. It's God's work. But I think we were naturally supposed to find this out at some point. Use the Raiders of the Lost Ark scenario, which is the Ark was found, but then the United States government put it in a warehouse and no one's ever going to see it again because it goes against science. Anything that goes against science will be hidden or discredited if all possible. So was this place built by a higher power? Yes, absolutely. Am I going to put a name on God? No, I am not. Not my place. But it was continued to be hidden by the secret societies and whatever, you know, Illuminati, Bilderberg, Rothschilds, Vatican, take your pick. But it doesn't matter because everyone's involved at the highest levels of the military to seal the sucker off. So but why are they hiding it? They're hiding it for power. It's plain and simple. They do not take chances. If there's a chance that the population will react badly and start burning everything down, they're not going to do it. They're going to try to turn it into something of their own design that they can use to their advantage, if possible. But I still have faith. I'm a big glass half full type of guy. And I think that the one that created this place has a happy ending to this story. I just have faith. That's all.
Yeah. The Book of Enoch actually, when you start reading it, it says the book was intended for the last days.
Yeah.
And it was found in the Dead Sea Scrolls, was removed as the general text 300-400 AD and then reintroduced. So in there is chapters on luminaries, and it also discusses about portholes and windows in the sky. So I think that goes along with what you're saying, that the intent was for us in the last days to discover that.
Oh yeah, let me close out my side real quick with the Book of Enoch is key. It's like a technical manual, not the easiest read sometimes, but it's like a technical manual to the world, this world in general. There was a guy in our community, his name's Zen Garcia, who wrote a wonderful Decoding the Book of Enoch and Tied to Flat Earth, and I'm butchering the title. But he made some fantastic observations on how the Book of Enoch is tied to this world. And one more little side thing. Are you familiar with the Book of Jasher at all?
Sure am, yes.
Perfect.
Jubilees as well. Uh-huh.
All right. I do not know Jubilees, but Jasher, I thumbed through, and I noticed there was something interesting at the very end of Chapter 3. Which was when Enoch was walking off the world and everyone was following him. He walked to, you know, because most of your biblical stuff is all about palm trees and deserts and people dying of thirst. But this one was really interesting because he was walking to an area full of, they were redundant when they said this, ice and snow and more ice and more snow. And that he was walking through that, and that he was telling people that were following him, because he had all these followers, don't go, that they couldn't follow him past this area, and they all had to turn back. And I thought that was very, very interesting because it was like, okay, if you're going to walk off the Earth, well, I imagine the land bridge existed between Chile and Antarctica, and you just took the land bridge and literally walked off the Earth, maybe. Or maybe there was another land bridge south of Africa. But it's, you know, the land of ice and snow and more ice and snow, is the only one thing in my mind, you know, rang true there. So.
Well, I know that that Enoch walked with God, and he had an incredible relationship with Him, and the fallen angels actually petitioned Him for forgiveness, and they, of course, they were turned down. So yeah. We've got about 2 minutes. Do you want to close out with anything or give us your contact information, your website?
Sure, mm-hmm. Sure. Let's do this real quick, which is my free site is enclosedworld.com. The subscription site is marksargent.com. You can go on YouTube and just type in Flat Earth Clues or go into any search engine and type in Flat Earth. But I want to... because I'm not going to convince anyone who's listening to this in 2 hours. I'm just not. That's not how it works. What I try to tell people, though, is, you know, question the world that you're in now and look to see how big this thing has gotten recently. When you go into any search engine and you type in Earth is or the Earth is the, you'd be amazed what you find. It doesn't say the Earth is round anymore. It says the Earth is flat. We did. That was a side effect of our community. We didn't even try to do that, and that happened just in the last year. It is something that has been growing and growing and growing, and there's a ton of material out there. Just don't listen to my stuff. There is, I'm just part of a much bigger community, and it's going to be a heck of a year.
Yes. Well, what I'd like to do is in the future is get with you since you've done some research on the hollow earth theory and so forth. I'd like to continue on that, so maybe we can have you back again.
Sure, I'd love to be back.
Okay, well, thank you, and thank you for taking the time, because it's a lot of effort to spend 2 hours, and you did a very good job, and I thank you very much, okay?
Very welcome.
All right, good night.